From Simon & Schuster Audio. What liberal media? The truth about bias and the news. By Eric Alterman. Read by the author.
What Liberal Media by Eric Alterman. That's me. Bias, slander, and BS. Only a liberal would be dumb enough to title a book, What Liberal Media? Listen to just about anyone and the answer's obvious. What are you, stupid? Just pick up a newspaper or turn on your TV. America's argument about media bias features just two points of view. The right argues that the media is biased toward leftists. The other side responds, to quote David Broder, dean of the Washington Press Corps, there just isn't enough ideology in the average reporter to fill a thimble. The idea that the media might, for reasons of ownership, class, economics, or outside pressure, actually be more sympathetic to conservative causes than to liberal ones is widely considered to be simply beyond the pale. Social scientists talk about useful myths, stories we all know that aren't necessarily true, but that we choose to believe them anyway because they seem to offer confirmation of what we already know, which raises the question, if we already know it, why the story? Think of the wholly fictitious but illustrative story about little George Washington and his inability to lie about that cherry tree. For conservatives, and even more for many journalists, the liberal media is just that. A myth, to be certain, but a useful one. If only it were true, we might have a more humane, open-minded, and ultimately effective public debate on the issues facing the nation. Alas, if pigs could fly. Republicans of all stripes have done quite well for themselves during the last five decades, fulminating about the liberal cabal, progressive thought police who spin, supplant, and sometimes suppress the news we all consume. Indeed, it's not only conservatives who find this whipping boy to be an irresistible target. Dwight David Eisenhower received one of the biggest ovations of his life when, at the 1952 Republican convention, he derided what he called the sensation-seeking columnists and commentators who sought to undermine the Republican Party's efforts to improve the nation. The most colorful example of this art form, however, is probably a toss-up between the two quips penned by then White House speechwriter William Safire for Vice President Spiro Agnew, who denounced both the, quote, nattering nabobs of negativism and the effete corpse of impudent snobs seeking to undermine the nation's morale. His boss, Richard Nixon, who had been Ike's vice president, usually held his tongue in public, but complained obsessively in private to Billy Graham of what he called a terrible liberal Jewish clique that totally dominates the media, according to Nixon, and erodes our confidence and our strength. Just about everyone wants to get in on the fun. Even Bill Clinton whined to Rolling Stone that he didn't get one damn bit of credit from the knee-jerk liberal press. The office's current occupant, George W. Bush, continues this tradition, complaining that the media are biased against conservative thought. On a trip to Maine in January 2001, he quite conspicuously carried a copy of the best-selling book Bias by Bernard Goldberg, as if to give the so-called liberal media a presidential thumb in the eye. But while some conservatives actually believe their own grumbles, the smart ones don't. They know mau-mauing the other side is just a good way to get their ideas across, or perhaps prevent the other side from getting a fair hearing for theirs. On occasion, honest conservatives admit this. Rich Bond, then the chair of the Republican Party, complained during the 1992 election, "I think we know who the media want to win this election, and I don't think it's George Bush." The very same Rich Bond, however, also noted during the same election, quote, there is some strategy to it, he meant bashing the liberal media. If you watch any great coach, what they'll try to do is work the refs. Maybe the ref will cut you a little slack on the next one. Bond is hardly alone. That the so-called liberal media, from now on I'm going to call it the slick'em, were biased against the administration of Ronald Reagan is an article of faith among Republicans. Yet James Baker, perhaps the most media savvy of all of them, owned up to the fact that any such complaint was decidedly misplaced. There were days and times and events we might have had some complaints, but on balance, I don't think we had anything to complain about, Baker told one writer. Patrick Buchanan, among the most conservative pundits and presidential candidates in Republican history, found that he could not identify any alleged liberal bias against him during his presidential candidacies. I've gotten balanced coverage and broad coverage. All we could have asked for, For heaven's sakes, we kid about the liberal media, but every Republican on earth does that, the aspiring American Ayatollah cheerfully confessed during the 1996 campaign. And even William Kristol, without a doubt the most influential Republican neoconservative publicist in America today, has come clean on this issue. "I admit it," he told a reporter. "The liberal media were never that powerful, and the whole thing was often used as an excuse by conservatives for conservative failures." In recent times, the right has ginned up its liberal media propaganda machine. Books by both Ann Coulter, a blonde bombshell pundit, and Bernard Goldberg, a former CBS News producer, have topped the bestseller list, stringing together a series of charges that, well, it's amazing neither one of them thought to accuse liberals of using the blood of conservative children for extra flavor in their soy milk decaf lattes. While extremely popular with the media they attack, both books are so shoddily written and researched, they pretty much refute themselves. The danger derives less from the author's respective allegations than the "where there's smoke, there's fire" impression they inspire. In fact, barely any of the major allegations in either book stands up to more than a moment's scrutiny. The entire case is a lie, and yes, in many instances, a slander. Although I abhor the methods of both authors, I do not feel they can go unanswered. Ideas, particularly bad ones, have consequences. The myth of the liberal media empowers conservatives to control debate in the United States to the point where liberals cannot even hope for a fair shake anymore. However immodest my goal, I aim to change that. I first met Ann Coulter in 1996 when we were both hired to be pundits on the new cable news station MSNBC. Still just a right-wing congressional aide, she had been hired without much apparent experience as a journalist, but with a mouth so vicious she made her fellow leggy blonde pundit Laura Ingraham look and sound like Mary Tyler Moore in comparison. Coulter was eventually fired when she attacked a disabled Vietnam veteran on the air, screaming, "People like you caused us to lose that war!" But this was just one of many incidents where she leapt over the bounds of good taste into the kind of talk that is usually reserved for bleachers or bar fights. In her columns, published in one of the most extreme of all conservative publications, Human Events, she would regularly refer to the President of the United States as a pervert, liar, and a felon, as well as a flimflam artist. She termed the First Lady to be pond scum and white trash, and the late Pamela Harriman to be a whore. Coulter said all these things while appearing on the air in dresses so revealing they put one in mind of Sharon Stone in the film Basic Instinct. The greater Coulter's fame, the more malevolent grew her hysteria. In her 1998 book, High Crimes and Misdemeanors, The Case Against Bill Clinton, she wrote, "In this recurring nightmare of a presidency, we have a national debate about whether he did it, even though all sentient people know he did. Otherwise, there would be debates only about whether to impeach or assassinate." Such was the wisdom of the alleged constitutional scholar whose work George Will quoted on ABC's This Week. Shortly after 9/11, Coulter became famous again when she suggested in a column published by National Review Online after seeing anti-American demonstrators in Arab nations that we invade their countries, kill their leaders, and convert them to Christianity. Coulter's column was dropped by the magazine, but not because the editors objected to its content. Editor Jonah Goldberg explained, "We ended the relationship because she behaved with a total lack of professionalism, friendship, and loyalty." Coulter had called the editors girly boys. Coulter remained unbowed. At a meeting of the National Political Action Conference, Coulter advised, "We need to execute people like John Walker in order to physically intimidate liberals by making them realize they can be killed too. Otherwise, they'll turn out to be outright traitors." She also joked about the proposed murder of Transportation Secretary Norm Mineta. In her second book-length primal scream, published in the summer of 2002, Coulter compared Katie Couric of The Today Show to Eva Braun. She would later add Joseph Goebbels after Couric challenged her in an interview. She termed Christy Todd Whitman, the former governor of New Jersey and current head of the Environmental Protection Agency, a dimwit and a bird brain. Senator Jim Jeffers is a halfwit. Gloria Steinem is a termagant and a deeply ridiculous figure who had to sleep with rich liberals to fund Ms. Magazine. But the errors are even more egregious than the insults, and her footnotes are in many significant cases a sham. The good folks at the American Prospects weblog, Tapped, went to the trouble of compiling Coulter's errors chapter by chapter. The sheer weight of these, coupled with their audacity, demonstrates the moral and intellectual bankruptcy of a journalistic culture that allows her near a microphone, much less a printing press. If you doubt this, stop this program right now and log on to www.whatliberalmedia.com. Coulter's view of the U.S. media can be summed up as follows. American journalists commit mass murder without facing the ultimate penalty. I think they are retarded. In the New York Observer, published in one of the two cities attacked on 9/11, Coulter joked about how wonderful it would have been if Timothy McVeigh had blown up the New York Times building and murdered all of its inhabitants. Apparently nothing.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.